Welcome to the City Manager's Report. The City Manager's Report, a look at city updates and municipal news. And a preview of the next Oshkosh Common Council meeting agenda. Your hosts, Emily Makowski of Oshkosh Media, and City Manager Mark Roloff.
Thank you for joining us on GovTV for your City Manager's Report, the show all about the latest and greatest things that are happening right here in Oshkosh, as well as a preview of the upcoming City Council meeting. I'm your host, Emily Makowski, joined as always by your City Manager, Mark Roloff. So Mark, as always, thank you so much for joining us today.
Great to be here, Emily.
So Mark, we're going to go ahead and dive right into our hot topics for the first half of today's show, take a little break, and then we will go into the meeting agenda for Tuesday, June 14th, 2016. So Mark, kicking it off with the kind of a cool topic coming up next week, we've got a grand opening ribbon cutting event for the Boatworks area of the Riverwalk.
We've been waiting a few months. We wanted to do it when weather was good, and some of the work that was done over there was done later in the season last year. But we've actually kind of had a soft opening to this thing because of the different facilities that are there. And we're really happy, but it's going to be on June 16th. It's the same night as a Waterfest night, so the whole idea is come for the ribbon cutting and stick around downtown, head down to Waterfest and enjoy a whole evening downtown. But it's going to be over at the old Boatworks property, the Riverwalk that we constructed there, and this just gives you a little map to show you how to get there. You know, Ohio Street over to 4th and then over to Michigan, and just head straight towards the river, and you'll find the parking lot and the shelter, which is really a secret.
It's one of the coolest parts of that property, really, and I don't think it's been promoted much. So the shelter is awesome. There's bathrooms there, so if you're on a long bike ride all the way from the Wyawash and you're coming through, it's a great place to take a little pit stop, have a picnic.
It's a great place for family. You know, yes. The vantage point from the top of the bridge is just wonderful. Mm-hmm. And it is. It's a start to go on many areas of the trail, depending on where you want to go. And the bridge is just spectacular. And you'll be able to see all that. And then if you're a boater or a kayaker, the kayak launch is there. And it's handicapped accessible. Mm-hmm. We're very pleased to get a grant from the Department of Natural Resources that helped us not just with the bridge and Riverwalk, but also with the kayak launch and the shelter and restroom facility there. So it's a wonderful hidden gem for now.
I don't think it'll be hidden for too much longer because people are already starting to take advantage of this. So please come on June 16th and celebrate the grand opening of this. There'll be a little bit of a ribbon cutting, some speakers. I know the mayor will be there. And there'll be, actually be demonstrations on the kayak and canoe launch for how to use that, whether you are disabled and have those things keeping you back, or if you're not. There's both ways to use that. So it's really kind of a cool area. And I got to ask you, whenever we bring up the Riverwalk, I have to ask you what's next. What's the next phase of the Riverwalk project?
It's always fun to see. There's always something next. If you're over at Oregon by the river, you'll know that we're working on both sides of Oregon Street right now. We're not going to get all the way to connect with the bridge, but we are doing a portion over there near the bridge to just have a nice softer launch landing there. We still have to connect the dots between the bridge that you just saw and Oregon Street. We'll get part of the way there this year, but then east of Oregon, we're going all the way to the Dockside Tavern, so we're continuing to the east, so we're inching a little bit forward every time, and it's really worth going out every couple months and see what the latest progress is, and I encourage people to do that.
Yeah, they're consistently making progress, and it's always exciting to hear what the next steps are, and eventually it's all going to be connected, and it's just really cool, especially now that the summer's finally upon us. So another thing, now that summer's coming up here, is street painting. That's in full swing right now. They're out there painting the streets, and maybe kind of give us an idea of what exactly that consists of.
Well, we're going through, and of course we're doing crosswalks and other areas that we want to highlight in the summer. So, you know, first of all, be cognizant that the people are out there. They're only two-person crews, and they do put cones out and everything, but it can be dangerous for our workers. So please, when you see the cones and you see the yellow vest, to slow down, make sure you know where you're going and where you're headed and where people might be. because it's a very dangerous situation. It doesn't sound like it, but it is. Mm-hmm. And the question I get asked the most, you see the gentleman there just kind of swinging things. Those are little sparkly features that are dropped into the paint to make it reflect at night. So okay. It just looks like he's kind of shaking things around. Those are little pellets that help.
That's kind of fascinating.
Yeah, it just helps it shine better at nighttime. So
yes.
They're thinking ahead about what it's going to mean. Our folks are very good at what they do. They can paint in that straight line, but we do ask people to be careful when you're out there, because it's not just painting our crosswalks, but we're also painting sharrows, the lines in the middle of the street, and we want people to be careful because we don't want you running through that area that's freshly painted with your car,
mm-hmm.
for obvious reasons. It can kick up things and can cause damage to your car, and then you undo the great paint job that's just
exactly.
been done, and that's your tax dollars at work. You don't want your tax dollars to be going into your tires or anything like that.
No, we do not. And you know, you're talking about bike lanes, and we were just talking about how the Riverwalk is all getting connected. They're working on a big project for the bike lanes right now that's probably going to be completed by the end of next week, from Taft to North Keller and Sawyer.
It's on Taft Avenue.
On
it starts
Taft.
At Keller over by Dairy Queen. I guess that's
yes.
the best way to describe it. And it heads east past West High School, past Pollock Community Water Park, and all the way through Sawyer. And then east of Sawyer, that's where Taft connects into Campbell Road, which connects over by the Senior Center and by Fox Valley Technical College. And then literally you're in the Riverwalk area. So this will connect people over by Highway 41 all the way into the downtown area. So it's a dedicated bike lane. So, you know, when I've always talked about a little bit at a time,
mm-hmm.
this is what I mean when we're talking about those things. So with just a little work and a lot of vision from our bike and ped committee, we're now able to have a bike lane all the way downtown from Highway 41. It's a little out of the way, but it's very direct. You'd be surprised how quickly you can get downtown when you travel Taft Avenue.
Yes, and it's a great guide to use too as you're biking. So very exciting. So just be cautious when approaching those street painters, and we look forward to getting some great use out of those bike lanes. As soon as summer comes, we know that event season is upon us, Mark, and the first event that's coming up after this show is Irish Fest. Are you going this weekend?
Oh, I'm sure I'll head down there at some point or another. You know, weather permitting, it's some people want to stay away from the heat. It's going to be warm on
it's
Saturday.
It's going to be warm.
But I hear that they have cold beverages down there, so that might attract you. But it's this weekend, Leach Amphitheater. It's a wonderful event. If you like Irish music, you're going to love Irish
mm-hmm.
Fest. And but we have a whole bunch of other events that are going on throughout the summer. Irish Fest is really kind of the kickoff to our whole event city weekends that we have. Farmers Market started this past weekend, continues through the summer, and then all sorts of other smaller events, whether they're runs or bike walks, things like that.
A lot of different fairs and festivals, and of course the big ones like Country USA and EAA, those are all coming up too. And of course a question that always comes up is, how does this affect the police and fire? There's always the question of overtime and how much time of the employees is being used by that. So give us a little update.
Some of the events take a big toll on time, and you know, somebody might say, well, they get overtime, but it does wear it down because
mm-hmm.
we only have so many people. But we have a lot of events that we have to plan for. You know, things like as simple as the 4th of July parade and the fireworks, that takes a lot of traffic control. An event, quite honestly, EAA doesn't take as much police, but it takes more fire. And Life Fest has ambulance presence that we need to have. So, and then other nights, Country USA, Rock USA, a lot of police presence there. Even though technically the event isn't in the city, it's actually in the town of Nakaimai, but we provide services to the county sheriff's department that we get reimbursed for. So the taxpayers are made whole. That's
right.
The good news, but it's very time consuming, and it cuts into other things that the police department is supposed to do on a regular basis. So we can be shorthanded throughout the city in other areas, and if we have to cover these events, so we have to be cautious about that. Our police and fire are very dedicated and put a lot of time in to make sure that these events are safe. But it does it does tack on after a while, but it depends on the event. Life Fest, exactly. Not so much.
Yeah, so it's kind of ebb and flow throughout the summer for the event city, and we do appreciate our police and fire too, so that's great. Another really exciting thing that's coming up that everybody I feel is talking about around town is the D-League Bucks team possibility here in Oshkosh. So maybe you can give us just a quick overview of what that is for those of us who might not know, and then what the latest and greatest is.
Sure. Well, I reported before, but for those who maybe didn't hear about it, the Milwaukee Bucks, it looks like they're seeking proposals from groups that would be interested in hosting a D-League, a developmental league team, for the NBA team. My understanding is that the NBA wants all of their teams to eventually have a D-League team, and they've kind of put them on the clock. Mm-hmm. I finally was able to see a request for proposal that the Bucks were putting out, and it was shared with me by a local group that is looking to respond to this. We're assisting them in looking at potential locations, evaluating those locations, pros and cons, and every site has its pros and cons.
Yeah.
Meanwhile, they're putting together a proposal, and one of the big things that they want to focus on is local support, and represented in many different ways. They're getting local investors lined up for this, but they're also seeking people who are just interested in saying, hey, I'd be willing to purchase season tickets. So they've created a website called bringthebucks.com, and literally asking people to fill out something on that website to say, I'd be willing to purchase season tickets or be a sponsor. Mm-hmm. And they're compiling all this information to show to the Bucks that there is strong support for the developmental league team to come here to Oshkosh.
Yes, and you can see that support too. You were telling me before we started taping, the Journal Sentinel did a poll online, and it looked like Oshkosh was in the lead.
We were winning big time. The poll was what cities, and they had about five different cities, and we were far and away in first place. We had more votes than the second and third place cities combined. Mm-hmm. I think we offer some great opportunities here. We have a great history, as I've talked about before, with supporting pro and semi-pro basketball. I think we're a great fit for it. And we're working very hard with this group to help them evaluate sites that they can show the Bucks that are legitimate sites to look at. Mm-hmm. And we're looking at any and all sites. I know a lot of people have been, well, what about the Buckstaff property? That's certainly one, but you can't count on all of them, because we want to make sure it's the absolute best proposal that gives us the best shot of landing the team. And we have to respect the investor group that's looking at this. They know what it takes to win this proposal. And so we're going to work very closely with them and give them the best options available to give us the best shot at doing it.
Mm-hmm. And it would be so beneficial to Oshkosh to have a place like this, correct?
I think the impact that you're going to see from, number one, economic impact with restaurants and other establishments, it's also going to be a great land use for the area, wherever it lands. And then also it can be a start of athletic facilities that we can attract tournaments and things like that to the facility, because the Bucks will only be using it 25 dates a year for games, mm-hmm. days for practice, and after that it's pretty much open for the Oshkosh community to enjoy.
Yes, well, very exciting. Thank you for the update, Mark, and we look forward to finding out more next episode. Now it's that time of the show where viewers have the chance to ask their city manager about anything that's happening here in Oshkosh. We've put out the question to Twitter, Facebook, and email, our website, and we got a few questions this week. So let's go ahead and look at the question mark question for this episode. All right, Mark, so the question this week is, when will Merritt Ave be rebuilt?
Well, I think I'm going to give you a long answer to kind of dodge it a little bit, because it is not on our five-year CIP, mm-hmm. our five-year capital improvement plan. But you can go to our website to answer any question like this. Our website in Public Works, you can click on our website and find the spot where it has our capital improvement plan. And we actually have a map that you can take a look at, and it shows all those sites. And our map this year, what it shows you is it's color-coded to show you in the next 5 years. So this year, 2016 through 2020. And you can see that there's in the downtown area where Merritt Street is, there are a lot of projects going on. I think everybody can make a case that a street deserves and needs to be rehabbed. But again, we always take a look at other factors that are going on in there. Merritt actually would be a good candidate, except that water, we have one of the largest water mains in the city going through Merritt Avenue. So what that means is when we dig up Merritt, we want to make sure that we're addressing water issues there as well. And the water is in pretty good shape right now, but we may need to do some maintenance on that in future years. And then we're going to need to dig up the street a lot. So we want to time that carefully so that we're not prematurely digging up a street before the water needs to get worked on. So water really drives when Merritt's going to get done. Now, with that said, I challenge anybody to drive through the downtown and tell me a street that you don't think needs to get fixed, because there's plenty of favorites. On that map, we have a lot of streets that are going to be planned to get done in the next couple years. Washington Avenue, the YMCA is looking to do an expansion. They would like to get the road done, but we have to wait until after the YMCA expansion's done. We don't want to do it during construction or before construction, because that could tear up the road with construction trucks. We don't want to do that. So you can take a look at all the different color codes on this map and really get a pretty good idea. I would say Merritt's coming down the list, but it'll probably be in year 6 through 10 of our capital improvement plan. We only show the first 5 years in our CIP. Okay. It's coming, but you have to be a little patient. But meanwhile, we'll get Wagyu and CP and Washington done, and you'll have some other good east-west options throughout the city.
Perfect. And again, you can log on to the city's website at ci.oshkosh.wi.us and check out those maps on the public works page. Thank you to the Twitter user who submitted the question this week. If you'd like to send a question to Mark, you can email it to questionmark@ci.oshkosh.wi.us or send it to us on Facebook or Twitter, and we'll answer it on the next episode of City Manager's Report. We're going to take a quick break here, and when we come back, we're going to dive into the City Council meeting agenda for Tuesday, June 14th. We'll be right back.
It is sad but true that for years, some people have been using storm drains to dispose of their wastes. Sanitary sewers take waste from bathrooms and kitchens and clean them up. But storm sewers do not treat or clean up anything passing through them. Everything that enters a storm drainage system is eventually discharged into a stream, river, lake, or bay in exactly the same form as it entered. One of the responsibilities of municipalities that operate storm sewer systems is to prevent what the EPA calls illicit discharges. Illicit discharges are any discharges of non-stormwater into or through the storm sewer. When illicit discharges enter surface waters, they can kill wildlife. They can suffocate plants and fish, destroy breeding and nesting areas. Never pour or dump anything down any storm drain.
Back to City Manager's Report. Thanks again for joining us. Now it's the second half of the show. We're going to go ahead and dive into the City Council meeting agenda for Tuesday, June 14th. So Mark, first thing that we want to talk about is under the presentation portion of the meeting, and that is for the 2016 Acanthic Historic Preservation Awards. And this is from the Landmarks Committee.
Yes, it is. It's an annual ritual where we honor people who have the vision and foresight to reinvest in historical buildings, and we want to celebrate that and acknowledge that what they've done for the betterment of our community. Mm-hmm. And so the Landmarks Commission, former council member Shirley Maddox, typically makes presentations. And so encourage people to listen in and hear what wonderful buildings have been restored in the name of historical preservation.
And Oshkosh is such a historic place, so it's such a cool thing to hear about the things that people are doing to preserve that. And it can be a house, it can be a business, and it can even be a person. So
yes.
Very interesting. Next item we want to talk about, Mark, is number 8, Resolution 16-280. That's the approved resolution to declare end to emergency for replacement of sanitary sewer over on Washington Ave at the Canadian National Railroad crossing. And this is kind of an interesting item. A lot of people have been asking about it. It closed down that crossing for quite a while. That didn't seem like it was going to take that long, but it did.
Yeah, well, you know, the first thing is this is to declare the end of the emergency. We don't do a lot of hoopla. Usually it comes into my office and I have to declare an emergency. By code, the council declares the end of the emergency, but it's between the beginning and the end that everybody is interested in. And this was a sewer from the 1880s, so it definitely needed to be replaced. And we also discovered that there was a water main leak in there as well. So we actually took care of it very promptly. The utility part of it, the restoration of the street, that's when we require cooperation from the railroad. And, you know, quite frankly, it's not a high priority for the railroad. And they waited 2 weeks after we were done before they finished up, which was very unacceptable to me. I know our public works crews were getting in touch with the railroad on a daily basis to get them moving on this, and they were dragging their feet. I don't know all the reasons why. I mean, I'm not going to sit and judge, but I am going to tell you that I'm not satisfied with that, because with all the construction we had going on, this was a real public safety risk. It was certainly an inconvenience for the public, and I appreciate that. There were plenty of times I wanted to cross on Washington and couldn't do it myself. But it's the public safety part of it that's so important for me as city manager, because we did have some construction going on there. This was unexpected construction, and we wanted to get this thing taken care of very quickly. The purpose of declaring the emergency is to get the resources in line to get that thing done. Fortunately, we took some of contractors off of other city jobs and hired them on a short-term basis to get these done. And we're hoping that in the future the railroad is a little more responsive to these things, so that the residents aren't inconvenienced and public safety is not put at risk.
Yes. Well, thank you for the background on that and the update. We're glad it's open now, and yeah, great update. Next item that we have here, Mark, is a Resolution 16-282. That's the award bid to Capel Brothers and Diedrich Inc. for the Transportation Department facility reconfiguration for Transit Department. And that's a pretty hefty sum there.
It's over $500,000. The building is actually dates back to before the 1970s, when this was a waste-to-energy facility that was converted to transit. And there's a lot of things that we've just kind of lived with over the years. Fortunately, we had some transit funds that were are eligible that we were able to use, that had been built up over the years, that we were able to get this stuff done. But we also had to do other things, like make the facility handicapped accessible, which it really isn't. And there wasn't a good area for members of the public to go in and buy a transit pass. Literally, they were wandering through the hallways looking for somebody. It was almost like being in a maze. And it's very inconvenient. Meanwhile, the heating system was antiquated, and we were spending money on repairs all the time, or putting a lot of people that should have been repairing buses, and they were repairing the heating and air conditioning system. So that's all going to get fixed with this. We're very happy about it. The transit workers are going to, it's going to be better for the transit workers. We're going to have a training room for them, but it's also going to be more convenient for the public.
Great to know. And by, you know, fall, mid-fall?
The idea is to get it done before winter. We're going to, you'll hear more about as we get construction started, but there'll be a temporary trailer there for people, for the public to go and acquire transit passes and any business they need to conduct with the transit system.
Excellent. Next item we have here is the Accept Assistance to Firefighters grant from FEMA for $181,000 for some video training opportunities here.
Our fire department, whenever we have a citywide or a department-wide training, they all have to come down to Station 15, which is down by, is downtown, which really takes all of our resources and puts them in one area. So sometimes we have to pay overtime so that our day workers can go downtown. This will enable us to conduct training at a distance. The training officer will be down at Station 15, right here downtown. But all the firefighters can stay at their station.
So it's kind of like a Skype situation?
Kind of like that, yeah, okay. Very much so. Just more of a straight line, higher a definition. So
right.
when they're showing, making demonstrations, you have better visibility that you can see these things. And this will enable us to do training and have our workers, have our people responding to emergencies still in their home area so that if there is an emergency, they can get out quicker. So it'll help make things safer, and it'll also enable us to improve our training opportunities for our fire department employees.
Well, that's wonderful. I'm sure the fire department would really appreciate that.
And it's 90% funded with federal grants, so only 10% funded. A nearly $200,000 project, we're only paying $18,000.
Wonderful. Very positive item there. Next thing that we want to talk about is the acceptance of a donation for some bridge lighting on Oshkosh and Congress Avenue Bridge.
We are so happy. The Community Foundation is yet doing another fundraiser, and the idea is they want to kick this off with getting the council's blessing to accept a donation to light the last of our bridges that that we have on the corridors leading from Highway 41. In this case, they would like to light the Oshkosh Avenue Bridge, Oshkosh Congress Avenue. The examples you see are from the Jackson Street Bridge as well as the Main Street Bridge, which has color capabilities. We can change the colors, very decorative, making it more pleasing for visitors and residents as well. And they're going to start the fundraising project. I think they've already had a certain amount of fundraising done, but they want to make sure that council is okay with accepting these. So they want to accept it now, and then they'll continue with the fundraising efforts.
Very cool. I love that. It's such a cool opportunity to have some prettiness added to Oshkosh.
So, absolutely.
Mark, last item that we want to talk about today is approving the TIF district for the beach building. We've talked about this before in, I think, the last episode, so maybe tell us a little bit about what this item is.
Well, the beach building is the building that's immediately next door to City Hall. It's fallen on some hard times, but the owners, the new owners, would like to renovate it, keep it historically accurate, but put a mixed use of residential and retail there. I know City Hall folks are excited because there's talk of a coffee shop going in there, which is very popular.
I'm very excited about that.
Okay, well, you're one of those folks. But there's a lot of things that need to get done in that building, and they've done some tearing out of some things to get a feel for exactly what the scope of the work is. And it's pretty substantial. So the purpose of a TIF district is to provide some financial assistance to these folks so that they get an acceptable return on their investment, because otherwise they would go somewhere else outside of the downtown area. This way we get investment in the downtown area. We assist them a little bit to bridge the gap between what they could get with an easier development versus a tougher development. So we're very appreciative of them going after an historic building. So we're doing the zoning part of this and approving the TIF district at this time.
And it's not the final step. There's still a few more things that are going to be taking place after this.
Two more things primarily. One is, by state law, this has to be approved by a joint review board. The joint review board is all the taxing entities, the city, county, school district, of Oak Tech district, and a citizen member, and they will finally vote on it because all the taxing entities, and then also a development agreement that we will bring back to council at a future time, which details the conditions under which we will provide assistance that will be funded entirely by the tax increment district.
Great. Well, very exciting item right next door to City Hall. That's going to do it for this episode, Mark, so I got to thank you for joining us again today.
Always a pleasure.
Again, the City Council meeting is this Tuesday, June 14th at 6 p.m. You can watch it live on GovTV and on our website at oshkoshmedia.org. Make sure you like our new page on Facebook as Oshkosh Media, or follow us on Twitter for all your community and government programming and updates, or check out our YouTube channel on YouTube for government meeting replays and past episodes of your favorite programs. Thanks so much again for joining us on Your City Manager's Report, and we'll see you next time.